Hi everyone, this is Alyssa Collins. We're going to go ahead and get started now with the webinar. So welcome to our webinar, the second one for our AB 52 workshop. For today's webinar, sorry everybody. For today's webinar, we have Lisa Westwood from eCorp Consulting Incorporated. We'll be speaking on AB 52 and the CEQA process. And we also have Andrea Clark from Downey Brand, who will be speaking on implementation and compliance. After their presentation, we'll have a couple of quiz questions, just like yesterday. And then afterwards, we'll open that up for Q&A. At any time during the webinar, go ahead and type your questions into the question box and we'll answer them at the end. And quickly, just to go through tomorrow's agenda, we'll have a presentation in the morning starting promptly at 8:30. We have Connie Reitman-Solis with the Intertribal Council of California talking about cultural competency and best practices. And then we'll have Michelle Lapina from Lapina Law Corporation, who we heard from yesterday in the first webinar, giving a little bit more in depth on AB 52 mechanics. And then the rest of the workshop will be spent working on consultation practice and discussion, and then we'll have a Q&A. And just a reminder, it's at the Yuba County Government Center in the Wheatland Room at 915 8th Street in Marysville. And now I'll pass it over to Lisa and Andrea. Oh, why does it keep doing this to me?
Okay, so this is Andrea. Even though I'm talking second, we thought we'd go ahead and introduce ourselves, and then I'll introduce myself, and then Lisa will do so, and then she'll launch into her part of the presentation. So I'm a partner with the law firm of Downey Brand, which is based in Sacramento. I specialize in water rights and flood protection. I serve as general counsel to a number of public entities, mostly dealing with water and flood. And CEQA is a pretty significant part of my practice. And I've had a tremendous amount of exposure to AB 52 and cultural resources issues over the past couple of years on significant public safety projects where there have been also significant cultural resources. So that's a little bit about my background. Lisa?
Thank you. My name is Lisa Westwood. Welcome, everyone. As you can see, if you want to hit the next slide, please, Lisa? That would be great. I'm the Director of Cultural Resources for eCorp Consulting. We're an environmental consulting firm headquartered in Rockland, and we have offices all over the state, and I do have projects all over the state. And in fact, a lot of my clients are agencies. And I've been actually talking with a lot of my clients over the past year or so after having been consulted by the teams negotiating the bill language before it was signed. So I was involved in the bill negotiation at an early stage, kind of behind the scenes, advising people on some of the language. And so I'm very familiar with some of the issues with the law, and I'm going to be bringing that to bear on this presentation. I'm a registered professional archaeologist. Although I don't do much archaeology these days, I have about 22 years of experience doing it, so I come from that perspective. And with that, I'd like to go ahead and start with the presentation. I would like to just kind of briefly overview the presentation. As Alyssa has said earlier, I'm going to start and talk about the integration of AB 52 into the CEQA process, and then I'm going to turn it over to Andrea to talk about implementation and compliance challenges. Andrea and I work together on a lot of projects, one in particular that has been, where AB 52 has been a very important part of that project, and so we've had some experiences that we can share with the group as well throughout the context of this webinar. If we have time for questions at the end, we're more than happy to take them. We'd love to. I know we can't see you, so you'll have to type in your questions, and somebody will be moderating it and checking the questions. So we'll do our best to answer everything before we run out of time. Next slide. Okay. The first thing that I kind of wanted to just touch on here, and I think this addresses one of the biggest misconceptions that I heard about when AB 52 was passed or when it was about to be passed, was I heard a lot of people saying, oh, great, now that we're going to have this new tribal consultation bill, this new process, now we don't have to do all of that other outreach, all the other consultation for Section 106 and Senate Bill 18. And that's not the case. And I know all of you on this webinar probably have experienced AB 52 in the real world now, so you understand that. What's important to understand is that AB 52 did not replace any of the pre-existing mechanisms for tribal consultation in California. And in fact, what it did was it added a fifth mechanism by which tribes will become involved in projects. Now, not all five mechanisms that you see here on the screen will apply to every project. But you can see, and I'm not going to spend a lot of time going over this. This is a good reference table for you to have, though, at your desk when you're dealing with projects. But as you can see, you have Section 106 of the National Historic Preservation Act, and that's for federal agencies. That's not local agencies. And that's involving a different set of tribes that are federally recognized. You have Senate Bill 18, and that's actually for local agencies that are doing general plan or specific plan adoptions and amendments. You also have public comment periods under CEQA and NEPA, where tribes can provide comments on projects, just like any member of the public can. Now we have AB 52, which is basically what amended CEQA, and that's what we're going to be focusing on, of course, today, and we'll go into that in far more detail here in a moment. But I think that the overarching message here is that each of these mechanisms involves different agencies with different tribes. They have different noticing requirements, different purposes. They occur at different points in the planning process. And I think that is really one of the factors that led to the development of AB 52 in the first place. And that is that prior to AB 52, a lot of tribes were not being contacted or consulted at the earliest point in the planning process. Because when you think about the way that development and planning works in California prior to AB 52, if we just turn the clock back here, a lot of times projects would go through a CEQA process first that would result in a CEQA document like an EIR or an IS, and then later they would go through a federal permitting process, like for an Army Corps of Engineers 404 permit or an inclusion process with the Bureau of Reclamation, whatever type of federal permits would be necessary. And under Section 106 of the National Historic Preservation Act, tribes and federal agencies already consult, and that has been the case for a very long time. And so they were, unfortunately, a lot of tribes were feeling like by the time they were invited to the table during Section 106 consultation, that the decisions about alternatives had been made already. It was too late to change anything because there was already a certified CEQA document, and it was too late to go back. And so that was one of the concerns that led to AB 52. The other concern that tribes had was that in their minds, the CEQA process just in general was faulty, in that it was not addressing a specific type of resource, a tribal resource that only tribes know about. And so for those reasons, AB 52 really gained a lot of momentum, and it was ultimately passed in 2014 and went into effect last July. Now, we're going to spend quite a bit of time before we move through the next slides here. I just want to acknowledge that I'm aware that the participants in this webinar have already gotten some exposure to AB 52 yesterday, and you're going to have some more tomorrow. And there's probably going to be a lot of overlap. And overlap is good because it reinforces certain key concepts. If you've heard some of this before and you're already familiar with it, consider it a refresher, and hopefully you can provide some of your input during the Q&A if you've had experiences about this. Next slide, please. What I want to talk about now are kind of the main ideas about AB 52, what AB 52 did to change the way we do CEQA. The first and foremost, I think, is important to acknowledge that we talk about AB 52 as if it's its own law, but it really isn't its own law per se. What AB 52 did was it amended CEQA. And so when you actually take a look at the bill language itself as it was signed, it doesn't read like a story. It doesn't read like step one, this is what you do, step two, this is what you do. It's actually cobbled together a bunch of changes to the Public Resources Code, the CEQA statute, the CEQA guidelines. It's all kind of cobbled together and it's out of order. And so what I've tried to do here is take some of that and put it into a logical order that fits in with your CEQA process that you're accustomed to dealing with already. Because this does have to integrate very well into your existing process. You have a lot of things to take into consideration. You have to make this work with the Permit Streamlining Act, which is something that AB 52, when it was being developed, really didn't contemplate. And there are other things, too, that we have to, and Andrea is going to focus on a lot, mostly those issues, those kinds of challenges and procedural issues that have arisen since this has now been actually implemented now for a while. So I'm going to forego that, and I'm going to toss that over to Andrea here as the second half of the presentation. But the first thing that AB 52 did when it amended CEQA is essentially, in a fundamental way, it amended it to mandate tribal consultation at the very beginning of CEQA, as opposed to way down the road after CEQA into the federal permitting process. It is now at the beginning, and it actually tied the release of your and certification of your CEQA documents to this new tribal consultation requirement. It is really important to understand, and you're going to hear me say this a couple of times today, but now with AB 52 in place, you cannot release your environmental document to the public until that consultation, if it was requested by a tribe, has been initiated formally. And you can't certify your environmental document until that consultation, if it was initiated, has concluded formally. And I'm going to talk more about that when I get into the step-by-step process. So we're going to come back to that in a minute. But the way that we're doing consultation now with under AB 52 is a departure from the way that we've done it in the past prior to AB 52. It is with a group of Native American tribes that are referred to as California Native American tribes that are actually defined in the regulations as actually being those that are culturally and traditionally affiliated with the project area. And they are not necessarily going to be located near your project or in Yuba County for that matter. And that's an important thing to acknowledge because a lot of tribes historically were relocated and they were moved from their ancestral territories. So there are people that are living in different locations that, and so they may associate with your project area, but may not be physically located. And this is a really good, important thing to talk about, the way that those tribes are reaching out. And I think comparing it to the way we kind of used to do things prior to AB 52 is a really good comparison here. Let me just explain that if you were to roll back the clock and you were going to go to pre-AB 52, or when you talk about Section 106 tribal consultation, the way that it's always been done is that the regulated community or the agency, they're the project proponent or their consultant, will contact the Native American Heritage Commission and they ask for a list of tribes. And the commission responds with a list of tribes and the results of their sacred lands file search. And they say these are the individuals and tribes that are registered with the commission that may have knowledge about tribal cultural resources in the project area. And so then the process has always been, well, then the agency or the consultants or, you know, somebody from the regulated community is going to send out letters to those tribes, and then they're going to follow up with phone calls and solicit information. The way that we do this under AB 52 is the complete opposite of that. There is no mechanism for agencies or project proponents to reach out to tribes officially under the regulations under AB 52. The way that actually that the whole consultation starts is by a tribe sending a letter to an agency. And this is the first time that's ever had to happen in this kind of a format. The tribes will send a general request letter to each agency, and this is a one-time thing. And they send that letter, and I'm going to talk more about process in a little bit, but it's only those tribes that formally requested notification under AB 52 that get noticed for each project under AB 52. Now, they only have to do that for AB 52. For Section 106 consultation, which your projects will have some involvement in, especially if you're doing joint documents or anything like that, you're still going to be doing it the other way, the old way. But how you identify those tribes and how you consult is completely the opposite of the way that it has used to be in the past. Okay, next slide, please. The next thing that AB 52 did was it introduced a new type of environmental resource that to CEQA that has to be analyzed in every CEQA document going forward, and that's called a tribal cultural resource. This is not necessarily the same thing as a traditional cultural property, which is the kind of equivalent resource in the Section 106 world. But, you know, at some level it is. It's a resource that a tribe holds importance to. It's actually defined in AB 52 as a site, feature, place, cultural landscape, or a sacred site that has cultural value to that California Native American tribe. And there's a three-part definition, and this was something that was discussed a little bit during the negotiation of the bill language. How do you define this legally? And I think that goes to one of the bigger challenges that we have in implementing AB 52. To speak very generally here, we have resources that are spiritual, sacred, or religious, and they are very important to tribes. And you have a CEQA process that is very scientifically oriented. That deals in levels of service and, you know, amounts of particulate matter in the air, things that can be measured and can be quantified. And that's really hard to do when you have things that are sacred and spiritual. So that need to define what is a tribal cultural resource was something that was discussed quite a bit. And there's a three-part definition that ended up in the bill. And this definition mirrors a lot of how we see regular historical resources under CEQA. The first two, and I should say that a tribal cultural resource that meets the legal definition of a tribal cultural resource under CEQA only needs to meet one of the three that you see here. The first two are ones that you're accustomed to seeing already. The first one is that it could be included in or determined to be eligible for inclusion in the California Register of Historical Resources, or it might be included in a local Register of Historical Resources. Well, we knew this at the beginning, we knew this before it was signed, and we know this now too, that most tribal cultural resources do not meet either of those two criteria, because these are things that are sacred or spiritual, so they're very rarely listed on a public list of some kind. The third option is the one that seems to be invoked more often than not these days, and that is that if a California Native American tribe comes to a lead agency and presents what the agency feels is substantial evidence or compelling reason, the lead agency does have discretion to be able to say that yes, for the purposes of CEQA, this resource is a tribal cultural resource. And so it can use that agency discretion to make that. And that issue of substantial evidence is pretty problematic. And Andrea is going to be talking a little bit more about that during the second half of the webinar. But there's some special considerations that I want to point out about tribal cultural resources. The first is that tribes, not archaeologists, are the experts. AB 52 specifically says that. And that's because tribes have expert knowledge about their history and their heritage that's not represented elsewhere. And when we say experts, we mean experts with a capital E. And that's just like you have a traffic expert or a noise expert. So the information and the position that the tribes advance about tribal cultural resources, that means something more than what's coming from somebody who's not an expert. The next thing to point out here is that the concept of cultural landscape was incorporated into the definition. And the cultural landscape is a little bit harder to define. Cultural landscapes are not new to the Section 106 process, but they are relatively new to CEQA. And a cultural landscape essentially is a larger geographic area that includes a combination of natural and cultural features that are all associated with one another, that are related in time and function, sometimes in form. You can use the analogy of an archaeological district where you have a whole bunch of features of, you know, mine tailings everywhere, or you have bedrock mortars everywhere, and they're scattered over a wide area. Even historic farms and agricultural landscapes have been identified as such. And so these are larger areas. But one of the things that AB 52 says is if the tribal cultural resource is a cultural landscape, it does have to be geographically defined in terms of the size and the scope of the landscape. In other words, a CEQA lead agency is required to make a determination as to whether or not that project is going to have a significant impact on a tribal cultural resource. In order for an agency to make that determination, they need to know where the resource is, and they need to understand the boundaries of it and the qualities of that landscape that exist within the project area. And that's an important concept because these cultural landscapes can be very, very large and oftentimes are much larger than the project area themselves. So it does present a little bit of very uncomfortable position for tribes who don't necessarily wish to disclose the full extent of their resources that they hold most dear, but they do have to provide some amount of information about that location and extent to the lead agency in order for them to make a decision under CEQA. Another issue that is important to acknowledge is that a tribal cultural resource, these last two bullets kind of really relate to one another in some ways. These resources, when people talk about Native American resources prior to AB 52, a lot of people envision things like burial sites and bedrock mortar sites, village sites, rock art panels, things that you can actually see and you can quantify and you can draw a boundary around. Well, a lot of the tribal cultural resources are not necessarily things that are visible to anybody other than the experts, and those can be things like view sheds. So yes, you can see a view shed, but you, meaning a non-Native American individual, may not recognize that view shed as being important. And so it's not something that really can be identified by anybody other than a tribal member, and that's the reason why AB 52 speaks to the tribes being the experts. They're the ones that can identify that. But in some cases, those resources that the tribes identify as tribal cultural resources may also be archaeological sites. They may be village sites. And in that case, it's important to remember that you have to address it as a tribal cultural resource and as a historical resource under CEQA, which means you need to be addressing it in two different locations of your CEQA document. And that's because AB 52 requires that the discussion of cultural resources and archaeological sites be kept separate from tribal cultural resources. So I just note that because if a tribe mentions that it is an important village site to them and they call it a tribal cultural resource, yes, you have to address it in the tribal cultural resources section of your CEQA document, but don't forget to also address it in your historical resources, your cultural resources section, because a village site that's archaeological will also most likely be eligible for the California Register of Historical Resources under Criterion 4, and as such would be a historical resource under CEQA. So it's just a little bit of a loophole just to make sure that you don't miss that. Next slide, please. Now, AB 52 also states that not only do you have this new tribal cultural resource to address in your CEQA documents, but if your project has a significant impact on that tribal cultural resource, that constitutes a significant effect on the environment. And of course, at this point, this is when a lot of the planners just realize, you kind of have an aha moment, because this actually might be the issue that kicks you into an EIR. So it's really, that makes the consultation process all that more important, because it may very well dictate this type of CEQA document that you need. In other words, you may be thinking that you are going towards an ISMND for your project, but if you have a tribal cultural resource that is in your project area that will be significantly impacted, then that would actually require the preparation of an EIR. Now, granted, it may end up being a focused EIR, but it would still be an EIR situation. And so, again, that goes back to explain why the consultation that we're going to be talking about in this process, why it has to occur at the very start of CEQA as opposed to later on, because you need to be able to know if you're preparing an EIR or an IS. Now, you may already be preparing an EIR for other reasons, and that is actually often the case, especially with larger projects. You might have traffic impacts, biological impacts, air quality, so on and so forth. So you may already know that you're going down the road of an EIR, and tribal cultural resources impacts are not going to change that. And Andrea is going to talk later on about the kind of the implications of that scenario in real life and how to address that through, and how to time with the notices of preparation and things like that. So I'm going to pass on that for now, and we'll come back to that in a little bit. Next slide, please. The next thing that AB 52 did that's quite substantial is that it actually requires a formal conclusion to the consultation process. I want to take you back again to the kind of the way things used to be done and the way things still are being done under Section 106. when you look, if you're familiar at all with Section 106 of the National Historic Preservation Act, it requires lead agencies to take into consideration what tribes say and act accordingly and act in good faith. And there is a reasonable and good faith standard that has to be applied there, but they don't necessarily have to come to an agreement with the tribes. Under AB 52, this is again where there's a fairly substantial difference here. AB 52 requires that the lead agency make a reasonable and good faith effort to not only identify these tribal cultural resources through consultation, but to come to mutual agreement with the tribe about the appropriate treatment or mitigation of those resources. And in fact, you cannot even certify your environmental document until that consultation process has been concluded formally. And it can conclude under one of two scenarios. It can conclude first if the agency works with the tribe and they agree to mitigation measures to reduce or avoid a significant effect on tribal cultural resources, or if mutual agreement can't be met or can't be reached, and the agency can document its reasonable and good faith effort to come to that mutual agreement, then it can conclude the consultation without agreement. And then at that point, it can formally certify the environmental impact report or adopt the ISMND or ND. Now, of course, as a practical matter, when you're trying to conclude without agreement, if that is the case, then the burden of proof that you'd made a reasonable and good faith effort is much higher than if you are just agreeing or concluding with agreement. There's no magical number, and there's no time limit that you have to come to that agreement or make an attempt to come to that agreement, but you have to feel comfortable that you've tried everything that you could to come to an agreement before you conclude that consultation. And as soon as you do that, you document that in writing, and then you can certify your environmental document. Next slide. Now, I mentioned earlier at the beginning that AB 52 was signed in September of 2014, and it didn't go into effect until July 1 of 2015. So there was a little bit of a grace period there where everybody was kind of trying to figure out how this was going to all integrate into CEQA. Because the bill went into effect on July 1, it became applicable to all projects subject to CEQA, and there are two exceptions here. The first exception is that if you have a project where there was a notice of preparation on your EIR published before July 1, 2015, then your project or your CEQA document is not subject to AB 52 or the tribal consultation requirements thereof. Likewise, if your project had published a notice of intent to adopt a negative declaration or a mitigated negative declaration before July 1, 2015, you are also not subject to the requirements of AB 52. Now, here we are in August of 2016. A lot of those ISMNDs that were, about to be adopted, those have already worked their way through the system. So we don't have a lot of those left, none that I'm aware of. We do have a number of large projects in California where notices of preparations for EIR were published before then that are still out there. And those are largely large public safety projects, large infrastructure and water projects. I have a couple of reservoir projects that I'm working on in the state where the notice of preparation was done prior to that, but we're still working on the CEQA document. So we have a number of those projects that are still out there, and some of those larger projects take very long periods of time to go through the CEQA process. So just because you have a project that is gonna, release an EIR in another 6 months from now doesn't mean that it is subject to AB 52. At some point though, of course, all of these projects will work their way through the system, and everything will be subject to AB 52. And when I say everything, I mean that we're talking about discretionary projects under CEQA. We're not talking about ministerial projects. And there are some complications as it relates to the interpretation of the law relative to categorical exemptions. And actually, Andrea is going to talk a little bit more about that. You get to talk about all the fun stuff. I'm jealous. And so she's going to talk more about that. So we will come back to that because, and I mention that only because at this point in the workshop, typically this is when everybody says, what about CADEXs? How do we deal with that? So we will come back to that in a little bit. Right now, what I want to do is focus on the actual day-to-day process. And before I go through this process with you, I want to just kind of a little disclaimer here. This kind of process is fairly detailed. It does require somewhat of a working knowledge of the CEQA planning process. It's a little bit more detailed than your typical overview of how the process works. I'm going to go through this as quickly as I can because I can tell that I'm running out of time, but I will be able to answer more specific questions afterwards if we do have time left over. The process, as I stated at the beginning, and you can go ahead, Alyssa, and go to the next slide here. The process, ironically, you know, we talk about how this is all about AB 52 is how it amended CEQA. The very, very start of the process, though, ironically, is outside of the CEQA process. And that's where I talked about earlier the departure in how we reach out to tribes. The process starts with the Native American Heritage Commission assembling a master list of agencies. And this list of agencies actually is a list they've never had to put together before, because to date, the commission has only maintained lists of sacred lands, lists of tribes. So my understanding is that the Office of Planning and Research stepped in and provided them with their database so that any time, for example, when an agency submitted a CEQA document to the clearinghouse, it got entered into a database as a lead agency, and name and contact information and so on and so forth. And that actually was translated into an Excel spreadsheet and published on NAHC's website. And this actually, fortunately, has been updated a number of times as information was recognized as being outdated. So it is being continually updated, which is a good thing. But the way that the whole process works is the tribes go to the commission, and they see this list of all lead agencies in the state of California. And they look at that list, and they determine which jurisdictions, which agencies they feel they are associated with, culturally and traditionally affiliated with. And then go ahead and click the next slide. And this is an excerpt of that database. You know, I've put up here a couple of examples. The database and the website is up there. The URL is at the top of your screen. You can actually go to that, and I strongly recommend that you download and review your listing. Now, if you're with Yuba County, I've already looked at it for you, and I found it was interesting to me to see that Yuba County is listed as, the address seems to be correct, but it's going to your county administrator's office. It's not going to the planning department. It's not going to the public works department. And I bring that up because the county administrator may or may not be aware that these letters that I'm about to talk to you about are time sensitive and affect your project planning process. If you're not with Yuba County, maybe you're with another agency and you look it up and you see that sometimes they're going to defaulting to the city clerk's office, and they sit on people's desks at the city clerk's office and they don't know what to do with it, and the planners don't know that it arrived. It is extremely important that you make sure that you have a process in place at your agency to make sure that general request letters under AB 52 are funneled to the right people, because this change to CEQA affects everybody in your agency and every department or division that would serve as a lead agency. Some small agencies, you have one group of planners and they do the planning for everything, but then you have larger agencies like Caltrans, like cities and counties and really urban areas where you have different divisions. A lot of times, in my experience, the planning division is not necessarily communicating with the public works division, yet both of them serve as an autonomous lead agency under CEQA. When a tribe sends a letter to an agency, they're sending it to the entire agency, so it applies to everybody. So it would not be the case that you would have one set of tribal letters for public works and another one for the planning department. It's all for the entire city, unless the tribe has told you they only want to consult on public works projects. I haven't yet seen that be the case, but it is important to know that. This general request letter that I'm talking about is what formulates the list from which you send out letters on every project. This is a one-time thing where a tribe sends a letter to you to tell you officially that they want to be noticed under for all CEQA projects under your jurisdiction, and they have to give you the name and the contact information for whoever they want you to send that notice to. And they only do this once, and there's no time limit by which they have to do this. It is essentially a moving target in the sense that you have a list now maybe you've received one general request letter or maybe three general request letters. 6 months from now, you may have two more in your hands. And so you have to adjust your noticing requirements as new letters come in. And Andrea is going to talk more about that a little bit later. So I'm going to go ahead and go to the next slide here. Now, what happens now is, let's just say, for example, we're going to just use a hypothetical example that you have two general request letters that you've received from two different tribes in your area. That becomes your list. You have a list of two tribes for AB 52. And the tribe sends that letter, and you need to keep that in a file because that'll apply to every single project. It is not project specific. Now go ahead and click it one more time. There we go. Now what we're going to do is we're going to take our hypothetical scenario and we're going to fast forward to the CEQA process. At some point in the process, or at some point in time, you're going to have in front of you, and I'm talking you meaning, you know, a planner at your agency, you're going to have on your desk an application or a proposal from somebody to do a project, to do a discretionary project. And so when I say application, you know, that either internal or external, in the sense that it could be a private sector developer coming before you and wanting to do a subdivision, or it could be a public works person that wants to do some, you know, road realignment or something. It could be an internal agency project. Either way, if it's a discretionary project and it's subject to CEQA, it goes through this process. So you're a planner and you have on your desk this this information. You have a project location map and you have a description and so on and so forth. And first thing you're going to do is you're going to review it to determine whether or not it's complete. And as soon as you make that determination that you have enough information, that you have a project under CEQA and you have enough information to begin a CEQA review, that decision point represents a very important milestone in this process. It actually triggers two different timelines. It triggers compliance with the Permit Streamlining Act because you have 30 days to complete an initial study unless you get an additional 15-day extension by mutual agreement. And it also triggers the need to send out a letter to those two tribes, or how many tribes that had sent you general request letters. We're going to say two for the purposes of the discussion. You have 14 days to send them a notice of that particular project. That's 14 calendar days, not 14 business days. And so you have to, and AB 52 is very specific about what you have to put into that letter. You have to tell them that you have this project. You have to give them a project description and a map. And you are specifically required by AB 52 to tell that individual that they have 30 days to respond to this offer to consult on this particular project. And that starts a 30-day window. Now, at the end of the 30-day window, if you think about it where you were from the start of CEQA, you had 14 days to send a letter, and you have 30 days to wait for a response. That's 44 days. If you are working with the Permit Streamlining Act and you have 30 days to complete your initial study plus you get your 15-day extension, that gives you 45 days. So if at the end of that 30-day window no tribes respond, you've cleared your Permit Streamlining Act compliance by one day, which is pretty narrow, pretty narrow margin there. But that 30-day window is important for a couple of reasons. First of all, if nobody responds, if those two tribes don't respond within that 30 days to either say they don't want to consult or they just fail to respond, then you document that in the CEQA document and in your administrative record and you move on. And at that point in the process, the risk level for moving forward with an ISM&D as opposed to an EIR is much reduced. And Andrea is going to talk about that in a little bit more detail here in the second half. Within 30 days, though, if either of the tribes respond in writing or in email to say that they want to consult, they're accepting that opportunity, then the lead agency is required under AB 52 to initiate that consultation within 30 days of receiving the request. That's an important, point there because it's not 30 days from the end of the 30-day initial window. It's 30 days from receiving that request to consult, which means if tribes A responds on day 10, and tribe B responds on day 20, you have two 30-day windows that you need to track going forward to make sure that you formally initiate that consultation. And I strongly recommend that you do that in writing because as we know, at the end of the day, it's important to document your compliance. Make sure that you're checking all those boxes and that you're giving the tribes the opportunity to consult in the way that's intended by the law. So you want to make sure that you document that in writing. Go ahead, next slide, please. The way that the consultation initiates is actually, you know, so you initiate it within 30 days. The format from there can be very variable. You have a lot of discretion on how that works, and you talk with the tribe about how they want to do it. But I strongly recommend that you formally initiate that consultation with the tribe by inviting the tribe to a project orientation meeting, because they know that they're interested in the project, but they don't have that same level of understanding of the project details that the project proponents do. So this is a wonderful opportunity for you to sit down with the tribes and explain to them, this is what we're proposing, this is where the project is, this is how the process is going to work, and then ask them, how do they want to see the consultation process move forward? What are their concerns? Do they want to communicate in a certain way? Do they like email? Do they not like email? That's where you can kind of establish all of those kinds of parameters. And there very well may be an agency or an applicant tour hosted by the agency or the applicant of the project area. Don't be surprised if the representatives that are present at that meeting want to go back and talk with tribal elders. Not everybody that comes to the meetings has that information. There's just so many projects going on, they can't send everybody to every meeting. So sometimes there has to go a little bit of back and forth, and that's normal. But it is important to understand that we got now to the 30 days of receiving the request. We initiated consultation, but at this point, there are no more timelines associated with tribal consultation under CEQA. So we'll talk more about some of those issues a little bit later. But ultimately, the tribe needs to express whether or not they have a concern for tribal cultural resources in the project area. Remember, they're the experts, so they're going to have that information. If the answer is no, you document that in your CEQA document and you move on. And at that point, you would know that there are no tribal cultural resources. So the risk level of adopting an ND or an MND or publishing your NOP or moving forward, you know, is much reduced. If, however, they say that there is a tribal cultural resource in the project area, this is when the lead agency has to evaluate that information relative to those three criteria we talked about for the definition and determine whether or not they feel like substantial evidence has been met. If the lead agency determines that tribal cultural resources are, for the purposes of CEQA, present within the project area, then if you want to hit the next slide there. There we go. Go ahead one more. There we go. Thank you. If they determine that there are not tribal cultural resources within the project area, you document that and move on. If there are tribal cultural resources, however, and the tribe has identified them, it is extremely important to recognize that that information is required to be kept strictly confidential and cannot be put into the public record. And there's about a page and a half of text within AB 52 that talks about confidentiality of these resources. And it's also important to understand that we planners and the regulated community may not recognize the information as being sensitive. So this is why the consultation process is important, because you need to ask them what type of information do they feel is confidential and restricted from law. That need to maintain confidentiality is not something new. As all of you know, it is already a requirement under existing state and federal law. And in fact, right now, even prior to AB 52, you can't be attaching site records and site location maps of archaeological sites in CEQA documents. That's already been against the law. So this is just extending that now into tribal cultural resources. Just be aware that what you think is confidential may not be what the tribe thinks is confidential. So it's important to be aware of that. Go ahead, next slide. The next step in the process is that the lead agency has to consult. Once it's identified that there are tribal cultural resources in the project area, then the lead agency is required to consult with the tribes on the impacts to the tribal cultural resources. And this is something, and here's something that's very important to understand about the AB 52 language. It says that if a tribe specifically requests a discussion on alternatives and impacts and mitigation measures, that consultation shall include that discussion. And it uses the word shall, which to me means that you better make sure that you're, you know, listening to the tribe, and if they ask for that information, you make sure that you include that in your consultation process. That is, and there is information about that might be communicated to you through the template, or there's a letter that the NAHC did. It's a template letter that they provided to the tribes to respond to requests for consultation. And in that letter, it may be, that's where it may say we request the discussion on alternatives and such. So just be aware that that request may come in many different forms. At this point in the process, of course, maybe the latest point in the process where you actually know whether or not there's going to be a significant impact on a tribal cultural resource, you still may not know whether or not you're going down the road of an EIR at this point. The question that you have to answer is, will the project significantly impact the tribal cultural resources? And that, to answer that question, that's a little bit more troublesome. Andrea is going to tackle that a little bit more in the second half here. That's not an easy question to answer. But if the answer is no, if you're going to have, maybe you have a tribal cultural resource in your project area, but the project is not going to significantly impact it, then you document that in your CEQA document and you move on. But if the answer is yes, then the lead agency is required by AB 52 to make that reasonable and good faith effort to agree to mitigation measures with the tribe or the tribes. Go ahead and hit the next one. If there is, let me pause for just a second here. This is where I think it gets a little bit tricky for planners, because even though AB 52 changed a lot about the way that we deal with tribal consultation, there are some things that AB 52 didn't change about CEQA. It didn't change the fact that CEQA says that mitigation measures are not required for effects that are not found to be significant. It didn't change the fact that it says that mitigation measures must be roughly proportional to the impacts of the project. But it's really hard to apply those to types of resources that are not necessarily physical or manifest themselves in the project area in a way that a typical resource would be. But you have to make that effort to come to that agreement. If you hit enter again, oops, back up again. AB 52 actually gives you some suggestions as to how you might actually mitigate for impacts to tribal cultural resources. It suggests things like preservation and avoidance, protecting cultural character, traditional use and confidentiality, use of conservation easements. Those are great in concept, but there's some other things that we've been using a lot lately that seem to help. But I have to say that I'm going to suggest a couple of mitigation measures that you might consider in certain circumstances, but it really is going to be up to you and the tribes to determine what is the most appropriate mitigation. Go ahead and hit next. One of the things that you can do for mitigation is to develop interpretive panels. If there is a tribal cultural resource, maybe it's a cultural landscape, you can actually develop an interpretive panel that speaks to the importance of that resource to tribal culture. They're really not that expensive to put in, but it's really important that you don't, if you do this, that you consult with the tribe on the content of the panels, and that you also make sure that you don't install these types of panels at the locations of resources, because what you don't want to do is have a beacon that tells the public there's a resource right there, because that just unfortunately leads to damage to the resources by the public who don't have necessarily an understanding of why that's not appropriate to go around and dig. Next slide. Another type of mitigation that you can talk to the tribes about would be if there are existing archaeological collections from sites that are in the project area. You can talk to them about their willingness to have those collections repatriated or reburied, preferably as close to the original location as possible, at least as represented to me by a lot of tribes that I work with. They like to keep them as close to the original place as possible. But again, that information has to be kept confidential from the public to avoid, obviously, damage by people who might go back and start poking around. You also want to make sure that reburying the collections doesn't conflict with other types of requirements or permit conditions for analysis of artifacts, for example, under Section 106. And that's, I think, a subject for another workshop altogether. Next slide. Some things that a lot of, you know, it's important to recognize that a lot of tribes don't like, and I'm speaking very generally here, probably out of turn, but a lot of the tribes that I work with don't appreciate handling of artifacts or retaining artifacts, curating them, keeping them, analyzing them. They really need to, they really belong back in the ground. They belong back where they came from. Yet there's some desire among a number of tribes to be able to learn from that information, to be able to carry on that cultural tradition to the next generation. One thing that could be done is, with the permission, of course, of the tribes, is to do some laser scanning or casting of the artifacts to create replicas in 3D or actual physical replicas. That would still preserve the information, but it would return the artifacts then to the ground, back to where they came from. Go ahead. Same kind of concept applies with laser scanning on the ground, with terrestrial-based laser scanning. Again, the subject of another workshop there entirely, but it can be used to create digital imagery of archaeological sites. In this case that you're looking at here, it's a bedrock mortar site. Next slide. One type of mitigation that works really well with archaeological sites where there could be some horizontal buffers placed between a site and development are in the form of capping of sites. Now, this doesn't work on all projects, but if you have a project where there is an archaeological site that could be capped with a layer of geotextile fabric and then soil on top of that, and then you put some kind of a landscaping over the top of it with a deed restriction or a conservation easement to prevent future excavation and damage, that's one way to preserve a site. But it does need to be done in conjunction with some kind of a restrictive deed or mechanism on the property so somebody doesn't come along later and dig it up. Next slide. So those are some examples of what you can do for mitigation, but again, that does have to be done in consultation with the tribe. And only after you've come to an agreement with them. If you come to an agreement with the tribe about the appropriate mitigation, according to AB 52, those mitigation measures have to be incorporated into the CEQA document and your MMRP, and they do become legally enforceable. If you don't come to an agreement with the tribe about mitigation measures for whatever reason, and those reasons might be that the consultation process was not able to be concluded because perhaps the tribe didn't stopped responding to requests to meet, or maybe there was a disagreement about what's appropriate mitigation, is monitoring an appropriate mitigation or not, those kinds of things. I mean, those are all the discussions that end up getting had. If the lead agency determines that they can't come to an agreement for whatever reason, they do have the ability to use their own judgment, their best judgment, using some of the examples provided in AB 52 or some of the ones that I've provided, and as long as they document that reasonable and good faith effort, they can conclude. That conclusion of the consultation process is the prerequisite for certifying the EIR or adopting the ND or MND if tribal consultation was requested and initiated. So just as a reminder, if a tribe or the tribes that requested notification do not respond within the 30 days when you sent them the initial notice, then you do not have that same set of procedures you have to go through. You can go forward and certify and adopt at that point. Next slide. Okay, I've done enough talking for now, so I'm going to turn it over to Andrea, and she's going to talk about some of the actual implications and the procedural issues that we have with implementing this in CEQA. So Andrea, go ahead.
Thank you for that wonderful overview of all of the process.
Probably more information than everybody wanted, right?
Okay, so my role here is to talk a little bit about some legal issues that we're starting to see, some common questions that come up, circumstances that just aren't addressed by the language, by the statute, which is not too surprising. I mean, that often happens, that a statute doesn't end up addressing every scenario that could come up. And I would put many or most of these issues I'm going to talk about into the category of what happens when you take CEQA, which really has become kind of a box-checking exercise. You know, what's our threshold? Is it significant? What's the mitigation? And, you know, CEQA has been around for long enough that for nearly all resource areas, you have a general set of what folks agree on in terms of what a significant impact looks like and what a reasonable threshold is. And then you have the consideration of tribal cultural resources, which is a decidedly not box-checking exercise. It is a lot of it is intangible, and once you get through a few hard dates that Lisa talked about, you really are in a case-by-case, what feels right, risk-based analysis of how to move forward. And there aren't, as you would imagine, since AB 52 only came into effect a little over a year ago, we don't have published cases from courts to guide us. We have the language of the statute. We have the Native American Heritage Commission and OPR, which have been giving guidance to tribes and to the public on AB 52, and have had the opportunity to respond to some of these questions that have come up, so I'll share that when it's relevant. But so this is we're still in the early stages, and these are just the kinds of issues that we're seeing that have come up. So with that, the next slide. So let's jump into exemptions. Lisa had made a mention of this. So as the CEQA wonks in the audience know, there's two types of exemptions. There are statutory exemptions and categorical exemptions. Statutory exemptions are where the statute literally carves out certain types of projects from even being subject to CEQA, common ones, feasibility and planning studies, fees and charges. You know, you're going out for a Prop 218 fee or charge or assessment. You simply don't have to do CEQA at all because those types of projects are never subject to CEQA. It's a pretty easy conclusion then that AB 52 wouldn't apply because CEQA doesn't apply. And AB 52, of course, is a part of CEQA. Categorical exemptions are a little bit different. The idea behind them is that these are the types of projects and the categories of projects that usually don't have significant effects on the environment. So it allows lead agencies to say, we're engaging in a project, maintenance of existing facilities, for example, that usually doesn't have impacts on the environment. But there are in CEQA, unlike with statutory exemptions, there are exceptions built into CEQA for categorical exemptions. I hate this. The exceptions to the exemptions, it's like, it's a mouthful. But really, the idea here is you can rely on a categorical exemption unless there are certain types of impacts or unless you have significant impacts in certain areas. And so one example of an exception to the categorical exemption is a project that may cause a substantial adverse change in the significance of a historical resource. Now, it doesn't say a change in a tribal cultural resource, but and this exception has been around for a long time. But the idea here is that because from a professional standpoint, there is a high likelihood that tribal cultural resources would be considered historical resources under CEQA, that this is something that we need to think about before just applying a categorical exemption and moving on, whether it's you're maintaining existing facilities, or you're doing something that doesn't have a lot of ground disturbance. I see categorical exemptions on a regular basis for operation and maintenance of existing facilities. So the question here is, well, does AB 52 then apply if a lead agency worries that there is a historical resource that could be adversely impacted by the project? And on the face of it, it looks as though you probably couldn't rely, or you may well not be able to rely on a categorical exemption. And that, frankly, if historical resources include tribal cultural resources, then you at least need to figure that out, just like with any other resource area, before you move forward and rely on the categorical exemption. Well, how do you then figure that out if the expert on a TCR is a Native American tribe? And that Native American tribe maybe hasn't, you know, and you don't have any requests from tribes to consult, or maybe you do. Well, the belt and suspenders conservative approach on this would be that you do your due diligence, and that may include consultation. What bothers me about this question is that I literally sat on a panel with the Office of Planning and Research representative, and this question came up, and the answer was AB 52 doesn't apply to projects that are categorically exempt. And so this is, in my view, this continues to be an area of uncertainty, and I think it will continue to be so. I do think that a very conservative approach would be to go ahead and consult, or at least, since you're not, you know, you could, I guess you could argue that you're not technically in the AB 52 timelines, at least reach out and do some diligence, do some technical studies that you would probably need to do anyway, frankly, and then make a risk-based decision about whether to consult. Clearly, there's a downside to not consulting, relying on a categorical exemption, and going ahead with a project that partway through a Native American tribe shows up and says, wait a second, you didn't consult with us. Of course, you wouldn't want that to happen. So this is an area that I don't think there's an absolute answer one way or the other. I do think this is a decision that is on a case-by-case basis based on the risk. And I don't expect we're going to see a lot of a specific answer to this question unless and until really it goes up through the courts. And I'm really not aware of AB 52 related cases that have been brought in any of the courts at this point. Okay, next. So I have a few slides on requests to consult generally. So now that Lisa has given us the great underlying how this all works, the idea of or the issue of late arriving general request letters. So you'll recall that there are certain points in the process when you need to initiate consultation, you know, within 14 days of determining either that an application is complete or your decision to undertake a project. So let's say you've already made that decision, 14 days have already passed. You haven't yet put out your notice of intent or your notice of preparation, and then you receive a general request letter. I think this comes into the realm of risk calculation again. It kind of depends where you're at, and it depends on the nature of your project. Do you need to stop what you're doing and restart? Well, have you already released your environmental document for review? If you have, I don't think that necessarily means you need to stop and recirculate, but it probably does mean that you need to initiate consultation, or you would be smart to initiate consultation.
Notice them, at least.
And notice them,
right.
Give them the opportunity to consult.
Right.
Because if they do want to consult, then you're not really supposed to release your environmental document until you've initiated that. So the right thing to do there, and again, a literal interpretation as noted on the slide, is that you would, you know, really regardless of when it comes in. Now, it gets more and more difficult the further you get in the process. If you receive a request to consult on the eve of certification or your EIR, that's tough. But I do think that a literal interpretation of the law, it really is intended to put the onus on tribes to let public agencies know when they want to be notified of projects. And if that initial letter gets to a public agency and they are very late in the process or essentially nearly done with their process, I think that you have a better case for continuing to move forward through your process. Okay, next. Okay, when no tribes wish to consult. This goes back to the time that Lisa spent early on today talking about before AB 52 and now after AB 52. So before AB 52, generally lead agencies would proactively reach out to tribes that had been identified by the NAHC after the lead agency asks the NAHC to list those tribes, and then that input would be considered. So if you have not received a general request letter, the question is, do you still need to do that? And to my knowledge, the Native American Heritage Commission has advised tribes, right, Lisa, that that lead agencies don't have an obligation to consult with them under AB 52 unless they've requested it.
That's right.
So that's important to know. there is this language in AB 52 that I've quoted here to expedite the requirements. NAAT shall assist the lead agency in identifying the California Native American tribes that are traditionally culturally affiliated. But it doesn't go on to say the lead agency must then send them letters to collect information outside of or apart from this very detailed, deliberate AB 52 consultation process that's been written into the law. So from my perspective, I don't think the law, the letter of the law requires that agencies be proactive. I think the idea of AB 52 is that agencies are reactive based on the initial request for consultation that they receive from California Native American tribes. It's important, you know, one of the themes I'll be talking about this throughout my entire talk is document, document, document. Along those lines, if you haven't received any letters and you're about to publish something, you document in your TCR section, because remember, AB 52 is not just consultation, it's also the substantive analysis of tribal culture resources in your EIR, whether you've received consultation letters or not. So document that in the TCR section. You still need to do something to address TCRs, even if there are no tribes that wish to consult. And so then you, again, you have your sacred lands file, you have your ethnographic record and oral history, the types of things that you did before in your cultural resources section. And that, from a professional and technical perspective, I think is changing. And Lisa would be the expert on that because I'm just a lawyer, but in terms of how, of what the differences are between the more traditional cultural resources analysis in a CEQA document and what is in the TCR section, particularly when you don't have any tribes wishing to consult, because then you're really relying on your the expertise of your consultants to fill that in. And last here, we have the note from the NAHC that the failure to request notification does not preclude non-AB 52 tribal consultation. Sure, you can still go out and do and consult outside of AB 52. It just, I don't read the law as requiring you to do so.
Yeah, and the question then I think becomes, are the procedures for the consultation and the conclusion of the consultation prior to certification, do those apply? I mean, the minute that you divert from a legally prescribed process that's quite detailed, the question becomes, are you still either held accountable to that process, even though you've deviated from it, are you still allowed the protections and the benefits of that process?
Yeah, I mean,
either.
The benefits so, and the burdens,
exactly.
Right? I mean, there are some burdens of it, but there are some benefits mm-hmm. of it. So I would say that if you're going to go outside of that process, you may want to be deliberate about your goals. Mm-hmm. You may want to say to a tribe, listen, you didn't request consultation, but we're offering you consultation, and we're doing it under AB 52.
Or
assuming
not.
That you want those protections. Mm-hmm. If not, hey, we're outside of AB 52 and it's not our intent to comply to the mm-hmm. so that everybody's on the same page.
Right.
Okay. This slide is about unexpected general request letters from new tribes. As Lisa noted earlier, there is no requirement. I mean, any tribe in the state can request to consult with any public agency. And indeed, tribes that are interested in your project area may not be physically located near your project completely legitimately. Mm-hmm. And if there are questions, lead agencies can reach out to NAHC for information about tribes. I will say that a number of my clients in Northern California received a general request letter from a Southern California, and I mean the southern part of Southern California, Native American tribe, requesting to be notified of any projects. And it was very clear just from looking through the internet, or it was at least unclear looking through the internet, what tie this tribe may have to anything in Northern California. And so what a number of my clients ended up doing in that situation was to reach out to the tribe and say, hey, we acknowledge your letter. Thank you for sending it. Just want to let you know where we're located. And inviting the tribe to offer a little bit more information about their interest in the area not with the implication that that's necessary. It's a careful conversation. But what ended up happening in every one of these situations was particularly when the lead agency in Northern California said, we're working with a number of tribes in our area, this particular tribe said, okay, we will defer to those tribes. Thank you very much. We no longer wish to consult. And again, document. And that was the end of that particular correspondence. But so we are seeing a number of tribes sending out request letters in a blanket way. Okay, next slide. Okay, so late responses to offers to consult. So after, so within your 14 days, you have sent a tribe that has sent you a general letter, a letter saying, would you like to consult? And then you're supposed to wait 30 days. And after that 30 days has passed, you receive a response that says, yes, we do want to consult. So the first note here is pay attention to postmarks. There have been situations where a letter responding to an offer to consult has been backdated and has been either slightly or in some cases significantly different from when the letter was actually postmarked and arrived. So just as a best practice, which is probably not a bad practice for other things too, but in this area as well, when you receive the response to your offer, just hang on to the entirety of it, the envelope as well as the actual response. So here, if the lead agency complied with the noticing requirements and the tribe failed to request consultation within 30 days, the agency may go ahead and certify without consulting. So the rule of no certification until consultation is complete technically wouldn't apply. Okay. However, just as before AB 52, tribes or any member of the public could submit information on impacts to any resource, including TCRs. In addition, you have your public comment period, similarly, and public meetings that you could get comments from tribes. And again, you're technically outside of AB 52. I do think that this also falls in the category of it depends on the circumstance, because you may, for optics or diplomacy reasons, want to go ahead and consult within the AB 52 parameters anyway. I think there are some downsides to doing that unless you're going to do it on a consistent basis. You don't want to, I think it's probably sound advice to just stick with AB 52 and be consistent in how you're sticking with it. But I appreciate and recognize that there are relationships here, and I have heard from a number of tribal representatives that this, the 30-day response window and the number of days in which to respond is relatively new concept, and that folks are still trying to get used to it, and you know it's not fair to hold that against certain groups. And so I get that this can be a little bit of a gray area, but technically you can certify them without having gone through formal consultations. Okay, next. Okay, notices of preparation and noticing requirements. Okay, so here you have the law itself, which says, you know, prior to releasing a NAGDEC, mitigated NAGDEC, or EIR, the agency shall begin consultation. But you have this odd Legislative Council's Digest approach, which says, and caused much confusion, lead agencies are supposed to begin consultation before they determine whether they're doing a NAGDEC, mitigated NAGDEC, or EIR. And that's confusing in part because AB 52 also includes the concept that consultation can include a discussion of what the level of environmental review should be. In other words, a NAGDEC, mitigated NAGDEC, or EIR. But I think that the letter, this 2108.0.3.1b is what really should guide us on this. And it's really the requirement to begin consultation before you release those documents, as opposed to before you even determine what kind of document you're going to release.
Maybe I can just briefly explain for the audience. If you're not familiar with the way bills are set up, what the Legislative Council's Digest is, if you happen to have a copy of the actual bill language itself, you'll see that the very first part of the bill is the Legislative Council's Digest. It is written before the bill was actually even signed, and it is intended to be kind of an executive summary of the purpose and the spirit behind the bill and the spirit of the law. It's written in future tense, as a matter of fact. It is not, I've been going around and asking a lot of people over at OPR. They all agree that the Legislative Council's Digest is there to help you understand the spirit of it, but it is not the law itself, and that's important to note. So when you're looking at the language, and I always recommend that whenever there's a question about what you should or shouldn't be doing, you always go back to the actual bill language itself, not to somebody's interpretation. When you look at that, just make sure that you're aware that, you know, there is that section at the beginning, and I would say that for the most part, you should be ignoring the Legislative Council's Digest if you're looking to interpret the requirements of the law.
Okay, let's go to the next page. So just a reminder on the clear, where there's clarity in AB 52 about timing of releasing documents and consultation, it is in these first two points. You may not release your environmental document until you have initiated consultation where it has been requested. So you don't have to complete your consultation before you put out a draft EIR. You have to have initiated it. You can still be consulting when you release your draft EIR. Now, again, the devil's in the details here. You may not want to release your draft EIR until you're done with consultation. It kind of depends on the nature of the consultation and what you're learning in the course of the consultation. But again, if you know you're going to be releasing an EIR and you've begun consultation, then the law allows you to go ahead and release that. You cannot certify your document at the end of the process until consultation, if initiated, has concluded. And as Lisa talked about before, that conclusion should be formalized in a letter. And that letter should say, thank you for consulting. This is when we started. These are the topics we've consulted on. And we've either agreed to mitigation measures and they are reflected in the CEQA document, or we haven't agreed, or we've agreed in some places and that's included and we haven't agreed in other places, so that you have that on the record. Again, document, document, document. I think that conclusion letter is really critical for the record because of the specificity of this requirement that you may not certify it until, and you don't want to be in a situation where one or party or the other doesn't think that consultation has yet concluded, and yet you've gone and certified your document. Notices of preparation, this is a little bit of a tricky area, because a notice of preparation is a document where you're telling the public, we are going to prepare an EIR. Of course, an NOP also has a bunch of boxes to check about where you think you may have impacts. And so it's not an environmental document, so you don't necessarily have to begin consultation before you release your NOP, but you need to be thoughtful about how you fill it out. If you have received letters requesting consultation, and if you haven't yet begun, and you really should have, I think, begun your consultation by the time you send out your NOP, so that you have some sense of where things are headed, so that you can properly identify in your NOP to the public what you're going to be talking about. But this question of being at the point, I mean, it used before AB 52, it was a pretty internal decision by lead agencies as to whether you were going in the direction of a NAICDAC or an EIR. Again, the purpose of AB 52 is to have meaningful consultation at the beginning of the process. So it shouldn't surprise us that decision of whether you're going with a NAICDAC or an EIR is no longer just an internal decision by a lead agency. And this complication of when to put out your notice of preparation and where you are in the consultation process is a result of that. Okay, so substantial evidence. I mean, the substantial evidence and significance of impact. So Lisa described before when she talked about the definition of TCRs, it was one of those three criteria, and the third one, of course, is that a lead agency determines that a resource is a TCR, and that determination is supported by substantial evidence. Now, substantial evidence is defined, as noted on the sheet here, in CEQA, as a fact, a reasonable assumption predicated upon fact, or expert opinion supported by fact. And again, we have the concept in AB 52 that the tribes are, California Native American tribes, are the experts on TCRs. And so it puts lead agencies in a little bit of a different and arguably difficult spot, because to date, lead agencies have relied on themselves or on the archaeological community and their consultants on these issues. And so it does create a little bit of uncertainty about what exactly does that substantial evidence look like. And, you know, I actually haven't, in the work that I've done with AB 52, there hasn't been a lot of question one way or the other about whether there was substantial evidence. But I think the point here is that even where everybody's in agreement that it makes sense that something is a TCR, lead agencies still need to support that with substantial evidence. And right. So it's something that you need to pay attention to.
Well, and on top of that, you know, the definition of substantial evidence uses the word fact three times, yet you're dealing with resources that are spiritual, religious, sacred, that no amount of science can ever measure. And so how do you take this kind of a definition and apply it to something like that? It is a really difficult situation.
Right. So along those lines, you know, agencies still have discretion to determine what substantial evidence is. Again, it remains to be seen how courts will view this, because we don't have any cases yet. But there's a few bullets here about when you're evaluating and how you're supporting your determination of a TCR, the types of things you might look at. Geographic or physical manifestation of the TCR inside the project area, ethnographic evidence, the contact period, you know, the timing, and oral history from the tribe. So these are the types of things. This is very case by case, and so it's kind of hard to talk generally about it, but these are some of the criteria you'd want to be looking at. Determining the significance of impacts on TCRs. So we know that the law provides that any substantial change to a TCR is viewed as a significant impact on the environment. And really here, we're talking about the project changing the significance of the resource. So are you impacting the resource in a way that is eliminating or undermining its significance? Well, the answer to that question depends on from where it derives its significance. And so again, it really depends on the type of resource. You have a burial area that, if it's destroyed by a project or altered by a project, it seems pretty clear that its significance would be undermined. But what about a landscape where a project impacts it just temporarily? And so you may decide that your impact is less than significant.
If it's a visual.
That's what I mean, a visual impact.
Right. Viewshed, or something like that.
Right, a viewshed. So these are tough issues that it's important that agencies think about with their consultants. And going on to the next slide, consider developing your own thresholds of significance for TCRs, really just like any other resource area, where you kind of set your own guideposts and then follow them. That follows here as well. And so this is a little bit more in Lisa's area, but your thresholds will probably be similar to what you're using for historical resources. And then also, because of what we just talked about and the nature of TCRs and how the basis for their significance is differs depending on the type of resource, you may have project-specific thresholds. You may not just have a set of general thresholds that will apply to every project, and that's something to think through. And so the question is, as I was saying on the prior slide, will your project diminish the qualities that made it significant in the first place? And there's a list of some of the qualities that you could find in this area. Okay, types of EIRs. This is an area ripe with questions. As the SQL folks in the audience know, there are different types of EIRs. There are subsequent EIRs, which I guess are the most, robust and separate from the initial one. There are substantial changes to a project. There's some significant new information. You're essentially doing a new EIR. It's more than just a minor change to a project. Could a case be made that TCRs trigger the need for this if the original EIR didn't address impacts to TCRs? I think a case could be made. This is an interesting area because AB 52 is still new enough that there aren't very many EIRs out there that address TCRs. Mm-hmm. So I guess you could make an argument that any new information about TCRs would trigger a subsequent EIR, although I'm not sure that's really practical.
How did the CEQA world handle it when greenhouse gases came online? Were people forced to do subsequent?
Not that I'm aware of.
Right.
That you didn't have to just, everybody had to renew their EIRs.
Right.
You have a new resource area.
This is the same thing.
Similar.
Right.
So as you may know already, there's not really a clear line in CEQA between subsequent and supplemental already. There is a clearer line, well, both of them are subject to public review and comment. There is a clearer line with an addendum, which is really more intended for very minor, technical design edits, changes to a project, and there is no public review and comment. One question is it new CEQA or is it a continuation of existing CEQA review? In other words, if it's new CEQA, AB 52 would be triggered. And I think the bright line here is if it results in a new NAGDEC or MND or EIR, then AB 52 is required. And we've just worked on a supplemental EIR that really, because it had to go back out for public review, we put out an NOP, it triggered AB 52 mm-hmm. and we went through consultation. Okay, so three slides or so with some suggestions. One area that is a cause for some confusion, or at least where there's some thought that needs to be put into it, is what is your start date of CEQA? And specifically, this relates to the requirement that within 14 days of determining an application for a project is complete, or a decision by a public agency to undertake a project. In my world, where I represent a lot of small entities they aren't land use entities, they don't receive applications which they then deem complete. Mm-hmm. They are in the category of deciding to undertake a project. Mm-hmm. And that is all over the place. So the advice here is pick something and be consistent. Decide, whether it's hiring your CEQA consultant, whether it is directing staff to put out an RFP for a CEQA consultant, it's important to figure out a point in the process when you as an agency have undertaken a project and then be consistent with it. And so we've listed a few options here related to completing an application and project description. Do you have that, plus you have funding in place? Because a lot of times agencies, at least in the past, have done CEQA review, and then it waits and sits until funding is in place.
Or capital improvement plan project.
Exactly.
You know you have a project coming,
That's right.
You have no funding to even start CEQA, even if you wanted to.
That's right. And, of course, you need to be careful about what triggers CEQA when you're mm-hmm. putting together those plans. Assigning a project manager or retaining a CEQA consultant, again, define it. Belt and suspenders would be to put it into a policy statement, adopt it, and apply it consistently. And then, of course, memorialize that date in writing for all of your project documentation. Okay. Concern about the appearance of being pre-decisional. The concern here is that agencies will put out a request for proposal or request for qualification, and the scope will be prepare a mitigated neg deck. And it begs the question, well, how do you know it's going to be a mitigated neg deck if you haven't looked yet, if you have TCRs? Or, again, the RFP says we're preparing an EIR. So one solution is to put out your RFP either more generally for CEQA or just to do your initial study checklist at first, mm-hmm. In recognition of the fact that now you may be consulting very early in the process, even on the issue of whether you're doing a NAG deck or an EIR. If you already know you need an EIR for other reasons, I think that's a little bit easier, but you still need to be thoughtful about incorporating into your CEQA process early these, and consultants actually need to have all this on the tip of their fingertips as well, because lead agencies aren't always up to speed on it. A smattering of other suggestions. Document. Develop your standard operating procedures and apply them consistently. This is, I think, easier, at least in theory, easier for land use agencies that have a steady stream of applications that come in and that have a process that's probably in an ordinance that's set forth. This is a little bit harder for smaller agencies that do serve as lead agencies but don't have the infrastructure in place where they have standard operating procedures, but a little bit here can go a long way to have a process that everybody knows that is going to be followed. How do you handle general consultation requests? Lisa talked earlier about making sure that as an entity, you know where they're coming in and whoever is getting them knows where they need to go and there's communication along those lines. Consider developing or having a consultant develop template letters to document your consultation. It's really critical, particularly where you have a lot of meetings between a lead agency or its consultants and a Native American tribe, that you are able to document what day it was, who was there. Of course, detailed notes of the meetings, much of that will likely need to be kept confidential down the line. Decision trees and thresholds of significance for assessing TCRs. We strongly consider at least considering developing them or getting your consultant on board with before your process starts, how are we going to do this and what do we need to think about. Have sample mitigation measures. I think as we go forward and there are more EIRs put out on the street that reflect consultation and that have mitigation measures in them for different types of TCRs, there will be a growing body of sample mitigation measures, mm-hmm. right, that we may not have entirely yet because, again, as Lisa noted, of those three criteria, many TCRs will not come in into the categories of ones that are already on lists that are established. QC checklist to document and verify compliance. Again, this is complicated stuff, and when you're in the middle of it, it's not hard to kind of get a little bit lost. Where are we? What's the date? If you get multiple request letters, keeping track of those of the 30 days for each different one can be difficult. Obviously, restructure your CEQA documents going forward to include TCRs. We talked a little bit about postmarks and letter dates that conflict with each other. Maintain a detailed administrative record on consultation. It's my expectation that what's going to be happening going forward in terms of litigation is that there will be a confidential administrative record that will actually be substantial mm-hmm. because it will incorporate a lot of the notes and reflections from both parties that during a consultation period, not just the specific locations of resources, which we typically think of as what needs to be held confidential. And then lastly, it could be just as important to document why you did not consult if that is the case, particularly if you're in a situation where, as we talked about earlier, you get a letter late in the process and you decide to have, to communicate, but not be informal AB 52 consultation. It'll be important, probably in your environmental document, to state exactly what happened and exactly what the path was you went down and why. Mm-hmm. So with that, I think we have reached the end of our prepared stuff, but I think we have a little bit of time for questions. I'll pass it back over to Alyssa.
Thank you, Lisa and Andrea, for a great presentation. We're going to open up the poll questions. So we'll do the first one and take a minute to respond, and then we'll do the second question. Well, we'll say what the right answer is, and then we'll go to the second question and do that one, and then we'll discuss it, and then we'll open up for a Q&A. So just take a minute to do the first one. So it looks like we had mostly people answer A or B. A couple people answer only A, but the correct answer is A or B, and we'll discuss that in a second after we do the second question. So go ahead and take a minute to answer this one, and then we'll come back and discuss it. Okay, it looks like mostly everyone answered the second question, which is see if the parties agree to mitigation measures. We'll go now to the answer slides and talk about what the correct answer is and why. So for the first question, the answer was A or B, and the second question was B, see if the parties agree to mitigation measures, which was also the correct answer.
Well, yeah, the first one was a little bit more straightforward, easier to answer, I think, than the second one, because the second one, it really depends on what your perspective is, where you are in the process. But let's talk about the first one first. We talked about the fact that you can't certify your environmental document until consultation if conducted or if initiated has concluded formally. And there are only two ways that you can do that. You can either come to an agreement with the tribe, between the agency and the tribe, about mitigation measures that become legally enforceable, or you can make that reasonable and good faith effort to come to an agreement, and you may not be able to come to that agreement. But either way, as Andrea said recently, you have to document that in your administrative record, conclude that consultation before you can certify. So the correct answer would be C, A or B, but usually not both. You either come to an agreement or you don't. Sometimes right. You kind of come to agreement on some of the mitigation measures.
You don't, right. If you document.
Right, exactly. You want to do B?
Sure. So after consultation takes place and the outcome, I can't see it.
Co-displayed.
Blocked.
Oh. The outcome displays that the project will impact the DCR. What is the next step? The next step is to see if the parties can agree to mitigation measures. You don't want to just document that there will be an impact because without seeing if the part before you agree, see if the parties agree to mitigation measures, because under AB 52, where the parties agree to them, that has to be in your CEQA document. So the next step would be to see if the parties agree to mitigation measures. After that, you would document all of it in your CEQA document and then move on.
So that's why A and B, I guess, are technically
yeah,
correct.
Yeah, technically you B could, is correct, but the prop, the, but first you would want to do B.
B would come first, then A. So. All right.
Okay, so now we'll open it up for questions. It looks like we have one And the answer is yes, you will get a copy of this recorded webinar, as well as a PDF of the slides. So take a minute to type in any questions you might have for Lisa or Andrea, and we'll answer them. So it looks like we have a question. What happens if after the 30-day consultation period ends, a tribe requests consultation?
I assume you mean after you have, so you have received a general request letter from a tribe, you have within 14 days of the triggers reached out and offered consultation, and you give them 30 days, and then more than 30 days later, they respond and say, yes, we want to consult after a notice has been sent out. Yeah, so you technically aren't in your AB 52 consultation requirements anymore. This is one of those ones that, you know, there some circumstances would dictate, you know, if they're one day late or something, kind of depends on the circumstance, but...
But I have, yeah, I have the law out in front of me right now, and it does say that the lead agency can certify the environmental impact report or adopt the MND if the lead agency has complied with those notification procedures and the tribe has failed to request consultation in 30 days. So the law is very clear that if a tribe does not respond in the 30 days, they can't come in at the end of the process and request it later. You can still talk to them, and they can still comment as a member of the public, and Andrea made some good cases for why that's advisable in certain circumstances, but the law is pretty clear that you don't have to take them up on that if they don't respond within that 30 days. So that's why, you know, it's really important that tribes pay attention to those timelines,
right.
And that's why AB 52 also says that when you've noticed them in the first place, your notice letter does have to include the words, you have 30 days to respond. So it's amazing to me that any kind of law actually tells you what you have to put into your letter, but it does go into that level of detail. So I hope that answers your question.
I'll give you guys another minute to think of any more questions you might have. I encourage you to type them into the question box. Okay, it looks like that'll be it for today. If you guys do think of any follow-up questions from this webinar, feel free to reach out to Lisa or Andrea. I can provide you with their email if you don't have it. It'll also be in the PDF, yeah. So thank you guys, and we'll see you tomorrow at 8:30 at the Yuba County Government Center. Thanks.